Next topic we proceed to is called interference. What is interference? See, interference is basically the phenomena of redistribution of light energy when two or more wavefronts or wave superimpose each other. For example, okay, let's consider the same example. Consider that this is a, again, pool of water where we are dropping pebbles here, here and here. We know that after dropping this pebble, what will be left with is crusts and trough, right? Similarly, for this also crust and trough, this also crust and trough. So, what exactly is going to happen when all these crusts meet? We cannot predict what is going to happen because due to one energy, one transfer of energy, the particle at this point of water wants to go in towards upward direction, that is in crust. But due to this, the other transfer of energy, that might go towards downward direction or towards the trough. So, whatever the net resultant is in terms of energy, that is what going to happen at that point. This whole thing is called interference. So, let's discuss interference. Interference is what? It is the phenomena of redistribution of light energy when two or more waves superimpose each other, right? Now, how do we tell, how do we interpret, or how do we study interference? We study it by a topic called YDSE. What is YDSE? This is Young's double slit experiment. Young's double slit experiment. In this topic, what we have a source where we have placed two different sources of light. All right. What is going to happen here? I am representing my crust with green pen and trough with red pen. Okay. So what will happen here? See, crust, then a trough, then next crust, then next trough, right? What will happen here? First of all, crust, then trough, then crust, and then trough. So there are points like this. There are points like this where both crust and trough superimpose each other. Like this wave has superimposed this type of wave. So if these two type of waves get added up, what should be the resultant? The resultant should be a bigger waveform, right? Yes. So this is called constructive interference because ultimately whatever the result is, it is getting added up. More, both the crust are like both positive energy are getting, giving resultant to more positive energy, right? So this is called constructive interference. We will also call this thing by in terms of maxima. So, constructive interference. So, now we know that there are two types of interference. One is constructive and other must be destructive interference. For points like this and this, what is happening? A wave like this is getting superimposed on wave like this. So, the resultant must be what? Either it will be the resultant of net energy. For example, let us say the energy here is 10, energy here is 10 units, here is 8 units. So you will be left with either 2 units, right? And if they are equal in energy, so you will be left with nothing. So this kind of, so I won't represent it with nothing, I will represent it with very small form. So because net energies, they cancel out only with special terms and conditions. So this type of interference pattern is called destructive interference. All right. Now, one more thing. We have, what was interference? Interference is the phenomenon of redistribution of light energy. What is YDSE? Young's double slit experiment is an experimental setup through which we can study how wavefronts are added up or they are subtracted. For example, what exactly happened when interference is occurring. So this is an experiment setup, YDSE, Young's setup. It was done in late 19th century. Now, what can we study from it? We can study a lot of things. For example, what kind of pattern is getting formed if I placed a screen here, suppose this is my screen, so what type of pattern will be formed here? Number one. Number two, what can be the conditions through which we can tell that this time it will be only destructive and this time it will only be constructive interference? So we can also give certain conditions. So this is what we have to study right now. All right. So we will do this Young's double slit experiment in detail. I have just elaborated what is constructive and what is destructive interference. All right. See now. I'll have to redraw this diagram. So be a bit patient and try to recall all my words. This time, this expression, see how this expression can come in your exam. This expression, I'm writing the main topic to obtain conditions for constructive or destructive interference. This is to obtain conditions for constructive and destructive interference. I'll go a bit here and there with the topic. See, this is my first source, this is my second source, and I've already told you that with crusts and troughs getting added up, what we can get on this screen is, first of all, at the center, at the middle point, we always get a constructive pattern, which is basically bright light. The waves get added up. On both the sides, we get destructive wavefront. So what I'm drawing here is this, these are called fringes. This whole pattern is called interference pattern. All right. This is how interference pattern are. This is destructive interference. So these are called fringes. Just a second. These are called fringes. These are. And these are what? Bright fringes. At the center, it will always be bright because the light get added up in constructive format. But again, we are going to prove it. All right. So this is constructive interference. Both sides, this is destructive interference. Right now, we want to obtain conditions for constructive and destructive interference, that when can this constructive and destructive interference actually occur. Now, to represent wave-like structures, wave-like equations, what mathematical expression do we use? We have studied it in class 11th, that to represent waveform of structures, we use y equals to a sine omega t. What are these corresponding terms? First of all, this thing represents the whole equation, which is in sinusoidal form, which is in crust and trough form, right? This a, suppose, this is my wave. Now here, these are crust and troughs, so these waves are traveling like this. So this is a two-dimensional geometry, this is a unidimensional, so I am representing it like this. What exactly is a? A is the amplitude. This we have already done in what? EMI and AC chapter, the alternating currents, right? This omega is what? Omega is angular frequency. And how do we represent angular frequency? This is 2 pi upon t. What is t? Time period, or this is also called 2 pi nu, where 1 upon time period is actual frequency. These are all the terms associated, and here this is y and t. So basically y is a function of time in this equation, which we do not represent, which is actually understandable from this equation, that y is depending on time t. So what value of y is maximum at what value of t can be figured out from this equation. So this is how we represent equations which are in crust and trough format, right, geometrically. So in this diagram we have two sources, source 1 and source 2. So let us say, go back to the definition. What was definition? Definition of interference is the phenomenon of redistribution of light energy when two or more waves superimpose each other. So we have to actually superimpose two different type of waves. So let us say y1 is represented like a sine omega t and y2 is represented with b sine omega t. Will that be sufficient? No, that won't be sufficient, because in these two equations, I have differentiated only the way, this amplitude, the heights, alright. I have to also differentiate between the timings of the wave. For example, these two, according to these two equations, both the waves are happening, the crest and tufts are happening simultaneously. So, I have to differ it with some angle. So, let it be phi, which is the phase difference between both the sources, both the waves, right? So, what happens at interference? The waves get added up either constructively or destructively. That is out of the discussion, but right now, the interference waves get added up. Now, A sine omega t plus B sine omega t plus phi, right? Expand this term with the formula sine A plus B. What is sine A plus B? Sine A cos B plus cos A sine B. So, you are left with A sine omega t plus B sine A cos B, that is sine omega t cos phi plus cos omega t sine phi, but this B was out of the bracket, so B here. Then from this part and this part, I am taking sine omega t constant out. So, I am left with sine omega t here in bracket. I have A plus B cos of phi. And from this term, I am taking cos omega t, which is automatically out because this is a single term. In bracket, I can write B sine phi. So, the usage of this, doing this thing is this. Usage is, have you ever heard about Fourier? Fourier analysis. Fourier was a scientist or mathematician who actually explained that these complex equations can be unified in a single equation if we change some character, some symbols or some part with some other thing. For example, the next thing what I am going to do is a part of Fourier analysis. This is also given in your books, but that word Fourier might not be mentioned. So, I just wanted you guys to know that what we are doing and from where we have taken that. A plus, let A plus B cos phi is equal to, let A plus B cos phi is equal to R cos of theta. Guys, this is very easy to remember. Where there is cos, you take cos. Where there is sine, you take sine. Simple. B sine phi is R sine of theta. By substituting these terms with these, what we can get? Equation 1 and 2. Try to remember these two equations. What we can get by substituting? See, I've also heard that most of students sometimes say that physics is based on suppositions, because we start our derivation with let this is this, then if this is this. Most of the time we start with this, right? But no, it's not like that. Physics is actually a practical thing. We have to use those terms because that is the only way we can ultimately reach to the destination formula, right? This is the way of finding the formulas. Okay, I can actually take this discussion to some other level also, but right now let's just focus on this derivation. This part has been taken from Fourier analysis. Now, if I substitute values here, what will be I left with? Y is equal to sine omega t into this term A plus B cos phi is R cos theta. So, cos theta R I am writing here, right? Plus this cos omega t into B sine phi, which is R sine theta. So, cos omega t into R sine theta. I am writing it here, cos omega t into R sine theta. Done. Sin A cos B plus cos A sin B. So, this whole term is in the format of sin A plus B. So, if you take R common out, you will be left with, in bracket, you will be left with this thing, right? And this is sin A cos B plus cos A sin B, which is sin A plus B. So, the whole idea of substituting these terms with this was that when I wrote the value of y1, I had a singular equation. When I wrote the value of y2, we had a singular equation. But when we started writing value of y, which is y1 plus y2, this equation came out to be this, which is a complex equation. To unify this equation to singular term, we use this format, and that we have reached our final formula, which is this. This is not of any use for us right now. Why? What was the derivation we were doing? We have to obtain conditions of constructive and destructive interference. We have to obtain conditions. Right now we have reached to a formula which is the final format, which is the final equation for the value of y. Okay, now y is equal to r sine omega t plus theta. Now I'm going to rub this because this derivation is a bit long and I need more space. We need equation 1 and 2 only right now. So after this equation, after this part, you will be writing that this equation gives the value of, or this equation represents the final wave form after interference, right? And hence r is the amplitude of the resultant wave. After addition of these two waves, there was a final wave form where r is the amplitude of that wave. Okay, so now if I could find the amplitude, the formula for amplitude in more simpler form, I can also find that when it is going to be maximum, when it is going to be minimum. So hence we can get the conditions. So I'm rubbing this all except this thing. We want the value of r right now to find our conditions for constructive and destructive interference. So see what we are doing. Squaring and adding equation 1 and 2. Squaring and adding, that means this square plus this square and adding. So r cos theta square plus r sin theta square is equal to this square plus this square, which is a plus b cos phi square plus b sin phi square, right? What do we get here? R square cos square theta plus r square sin square theta. This is equal to a square plus b square plus 2ab cos phi, this is done, plus b square sin square phi. If you take r square common out, we all know that sin square theta plus cos square theta is equal to 1. So r square, if you take common out, so you will be left with this, which is equal to 1. So here we are left with only r square. Here a square plus b square, guys, I did it wrong, right? This was supposed to be a square plus b square cos square phi. I don't mind writing it again. The mistakes are to be accepted and improvised. A square plus square of this was b square cos square phi plus the third term 2ab cos phi. Now if you take this term and this term, taking common b square out from these two terms, you will be left with b square in bracket cos square phi plus sin square phi, which again will be equal to 1. So ultimately you are left with a square, this term is taken, then this is this term, b square cos square phi plus sin square phi is equal to 1 plus 2ab cos of phi, right? So what is the final formula of r in terms of a, b and phi? R is under root of a square plus b square plus 2ab cos of phi. This is the final formula of resultant, and we have not yet reached the conditions that when it is going to be constructive and when it is going to be destructive, right? So let's move on further. What do you say, when is r going to be maximum? See, so now this is how you are going to write. R is going to be maximum when cos phi is maximum. So this is how you write, for constructive interference, for constructive interference, r is equal to, guys, can I rub this? I'll write it somewhere else. So this is the formula. Formula is r is under root a square plus b square plus 2ab cos of phi. Now for constructive interference, r is equal to maximum if what? Cos phi is equal to maximum, that is cos phi is equal to, what is the maximum value of cos phi? 1. That is phi is equal to When is cos theta 1? Cos 0 degree. That's it. Phi is 0, 2 pi, 4 pi, and so on. So, this can be written as phi is equal to 2n pi. This is the condition. Whenever phi is this much, where n is 0, 1, 2, and so on, whenever phi is this much, then the interference is going to be constructive one. You can also write it like conditions for maxima and minima. This whole equation or this whole derivation can be given to you, can be asked to you in exams by asking you the format. Find the conditions to obtain maxima and minima. Like instead of using the word constructive and destructive, you often use word maxima minima. So this is the condition for maxima, that phase difference has to be 2n pi, where n is equal to 0, 1, 2, 3 and so on. And what is the maximum value of r? What would be the maximum amplitude of resultant wavefront? R max will be equal to, only if you put the value of phi which is equal to 0. So it will be a square plus b square plus 2ab cos phi. Cos phi, instead of phi, we are putting the value 0. Then cos phi becomes 1. So you are left with 2ab. And what is this? This is a plus b whole square. Under root of a plus b whole square is a plus b. So this is the maximum value of amplitude. R max is equal to a plus b. Similarly, for destructive interference,